We know what our dry forests need. They need restoration, they need thinning, and they need fire. The forests, the plants, and the animals that live here are adapted to fire. They actually need fire to be healthy and to thrive. Fire is going to happen. It's not a matter of if it's going to happen. It's a matter of when. Prescribed fire is very different than the wildfires on the news. They're very safe, they're very controlled. They achieve what we want in the forest, they achieve what we want for the communities nearby who depend on those forests.
Yep, completed 90 acres today.
Fire for millennia played a natural role, maintaining open forests where all of the native plants and animals could thrive.
Before man got involved and started putting fires out and logging in certain ways, this forest maintained itself through fire, frequent fire. You know, lightning fire was so frequent, it happened every year. Unlike maybe some of the downriver tribes where they needed to have fire to stimulate their basket materials or their acorns or other species, subsistence species, I'm not so sure that we really did have to do that much. You know, that was the disturbance that kept our forests in balance, and we departed so far from that. We're dealing with conditions we never had to deal with before.
Sycan Marsh was acquired by the Nature Conservancy in 1980. Having a preserve like Sycan Marsh, we actually have the ability to demonstrate how these forests can be more resilient if we use fire versus if we lose these stands because of wildfire.
Like in this case, with just hanging this by a tree, with our drone imagery watching the fire as it goes through, mm-hmm. we can say, well, that smoke is probably coming from those places on the ground.
It's very difficult usually to get high quality data in fires because first of all, it's dangerous. And second of all, fires move fast and more often than not, you can't really get in ahead of when it's burning.
This is measuring the combustion efficiency, particulates and carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide that's coming off of the fire. And that's really an exciting process for particularly the chemists I work with who are continuously finding things and trying to tie that back to public health.
Prescribed fires are really a remarkable opportunity because you can go in and collect data before you burn, during, and then after it burns. So we get these very complete data sets.
Here at Sycan in this particular unit, our objectives were to retain the mature pine trees, reduce encroaching shrubs and juniper into the pines and into the marsh. We want to reduce some of the dead and down fuels on the forest floor, which reduces, in turn, our wildfire risk in the future. Sycan is a really special place. I don't know, it has a special place in my heart. The ecosystems are so diverse. You have tule marshlands, you have dry prairie, you have marsh fens, and then you have the beautiful pine uplands. We've done a lot of fire reconstruction studies here. And what the science has shown us historically is that every 10 to 13 years, fire would burn with low intensity, just doing its natural thing in the ecosystem. If this were to have a lightning strike or a human start come next year, fire would move really slowly through this stand.
Fire crews in Oregon are working to contain the Bootleg Fire.
The Bootleg Fire has been growing quickly over the past week in a massive rural part of south central Oregon.
And the biggest wildfire in the country has burned more than 400,000 acres.
The warming climate is making fires like this more frequent and intense.
Some of the trees, the ponderosa pine in here, are over 400 years old. They were. This whole area, these trees have all been blown over. So the force of the energy of this fire, just so incredible.
This fire has been like eating my lunch for weeks. I would say out of the 14 days I've been here, 11 of those days, our fire lines did not hold. The fire got past our fire lines, and we're now off to the races trying to chase it again. And the plan tonight is to burn the rest of this, pick up where we left off. I've been fighting fire for about 14 years all across the country. And this fire, the Bootleg Fire, is by far one of the most challenging I've been involved with on the ground. And one of the reasons for that is just the extreme fire behavior that we're seeing, burning through these over-dense, choked-out forest stands.
I saw probably 150-foot, 200-foot tall flames coming up over these trees, which is really in an area that hasn't been restored. There haven't been thinning treatments or prescribed fire treatments. And when this fire was coming up over this ridge, it was just raging. There were 30-mile-an-hour winds pulling air in along the ground. As a result, it started to pull all these trees down and snap trees off at about 15 or 20 feet tall.
With this fire, a quarter of our treaty rights area is burnt up. It's tough enough to find deer and elk and the resources to continue to exercise our treaty rights there. So thinking about that and just having those memories and that sense of loss, pretty devastating.
When I think about the significance of the Bootleg Fire, I have to stop actually and just try to collect myself. There's so much emotion associated with the loss and the devastation, the effect on people, their livestock, recognizing how important these resources are to the Klamath tribes.
All right, I'll see you there in a minute. One of the silver linings is the areas treated either through prescribed fire or thinning or both. That fire moving through the crowns will drop down onto the forest floor out of the crowns and becomes approachable to firefighters on the ground.
This is a really important base level of understanding. Pre-treatment, pre-mechanical thinning, carefully removing the small trees. Then you reintroduce prescribed fire. That sets it up to be in a condition where, at least our hypothesis is, that it's more resistant and resilient when a wildfire comes through. And now we actually have a fire that burned through here and gives us an opportunity to come back, collect more data, and evaluate that hypothesis.
Exactly.
It's really interesting to be out here now 3 months after the fire because it really reinforces some of what we were seeing initially. You know, we've got these places that we had strategically implemented forest restoration in order to protect ecological values, in order to protect the research station. And to see that those really were effective even in the face of an extreme fire, it's really encouraging.
Here, even though we're standing right in the center of this major fire event, this is actually not the fire. This is the prescribed burn. And this is a stronghold in, you know, potentially the 400,000 acres or more. In this aerial imagery of 6 months before the fire, you can see in this browned area, that was prescribed burning. And after the fire, you can see pretty distinctly that this area that was prescribed burned is really intact. And then the south side of the road that wasn't, got burned pretty heavily. That there had been prescribed burning in here was a major reason for it having survived.
It is cool seeing the bunch grasses start resprouting again already.
Isn't that cool? It's cool to see too, like some of these big, large stumps that are still here. It's great habitat.
It's powerful to see where we had conducted controlled burning all by itself, you know, years before. And those were surprisingly effective in moderating the outcomes from Bootleg.
The prescribed fire that we'd put through had created resilience where we still had a lot of green, healthy trees. The mature ponderosa pine survived in an area where even across the road, 100 feet from here, we have black and crispy. So it goes to show that if you reintroduce the process of fire and you start to chip away at that 100 years of fire suppression, you can create resilience in this forest type in a sense that it can stand up to a big bad fire like the Bootleg Fire, which was pretty exciting.
There's just so much more work to be done in terms of telling the story so that the Bootleg Fire, you know, didn't burn in vain, and we have such a good opportunity now to communicate our findings. I feel like while I'm not on the fire line, you know, actively putting out fire, I'm still in a sense fighting the Bootleg in a different way.
Yeah, it's a special area, the whole Sycan River. Archaeological evidence says we've been here at least 15,000 years. In seeing at least some of the treatment areas that we worked on, those trees survived, you know, something that gives us hope that we can do more of that into the future.
We all have to step up to increase the scale of prescribed burning. Proactive, ecologically based forest restoration can work. And when that work includes prescribed fire, the outcome is a forest that's more resilient, more resistant, and better able to adapt to a changing climate.